It's the Forensic Lunch. I'm Dave, sitting next to me.
Nicole.
It's Nicole. And of course, virtually with us, we have Matt. Hi, Matt.
Hello.
And coming on in the later segment in the show, we have Max. Hi, Max.
Hi.
And then Max, just so I don't get it wrong later, is it Burchard?
Broussard's good, yeah.
No. Give me the real pronunciation.
The French pronunciation is Brassard, but Bassard. Broussard is good.
Yeah. Bassard. No, Bassard's good. I can do Bassard.
All right, awesome.
And now I just got to switch back. There we go. All right, so I've got a great show for you today. I think for those of you that are going to be tuning in live, you're going to have lots of questions because we're going to be talking about a couple of interesting topics. Starting off, of course, usually we talk to Matt, see what Matt's been doing with his life. Matt, being in Denver, of course, is close yet, unfortunately, far away. So what I mean by that is we get to talk every day, but we don't get to have lunch together, which is very sad. It's very sad. The Forensic Lunch is probably the only time Matt and I get to see each other during lunchtime now. But, Matt, I know you've been up to things. I need to find a better way to see the screen than this way. There we go. All right. So, Matt, what have you been working on?
Oh, just been switching over gears from Rust to Python, been getting ready for the Sand Summit. So if you're going to the Sand Summit, make sure, well, lecture per thing now. It used to be split up into two, but now it's one. So you have to come see my talk. I don't get to tell you, you should.
Well, you're that's not true. I mean, they could just leave the room.
That's true. There are some people that have been known to go get barbecue throughout the summit and skip some presentations. So don't go eat barbecue during my presentation. I have some stuff I want to show you. But I wouldn't fault you for it either, because especially now living in Denver, I'm kind of craving some good barbecue.
I bet you
I have yet to find barbecue that I like here. I can't say that I've really gone out and tried either, but from what I've had so far, I've been extremely disappointed.
So there we go. That's the call out to our viewers, either live or recorded. If you actually know of good Texas-style barbecue, this is important because there are different styles of barbecue, and Matt is specifically looking for Texas-style barbecue in the Colorado area. He will drive for this. Don't think he won't. Please either say a comment via the live chat or leave a comment down below. We can get it to Matt, and Matt can report back on whether or not the barbecue met its expectations, because Matt does have high barbecue standards. So,
yeah. So, along similar lines, I'm really excited because I did find a taqueria the other day that does have al pastor, but on the spit, which is awesome because it's been hard to find that here. Whereas I grew up in Garland, Texas, obviously many of you know it was the start of the zombie apocalypse. but living in Garland, Texas, you find good taqueria's everywhere, you find the taqueria's that do al pastor correctly, other also known as el trompo, or trompo. Anyways, but that's been hard to find here. So I actually found a white dude that had his own taco shop out in Steamboat and hung out with that dude for a bit. He was pretty cool, and he does al pastor the right way. So I was very excited about that. I also thought it was weird that it was a gringo running the shop. But that's not also surprising, because if I had my own taco shop, I would definitely do it the correct way. So, you know, crazy things.
It seems to me like maybe that is like the upcoming destiny, Matt's Taco Shop. I mean, you just bought a corn grinder.
Yes. So the other thing I should mention of things that I've been up to is I just did get a corn grinder. I am going to make my own flour or corn tortillas. So I actually talked to a guy the other day. I was like, hey, I don't know where to get corn to make my own tacos. Because I want to play around with making mixed mall stuff like that. And it was this dude that's in downtown Denver that sells tortillas and chips to Whole Foods and some of the other places. So anyways, he was super proud about corn on his website, so I had to go there and was like, I called him up, and he was actually really nice and was like, hey, you should come by on Tuesday and I'll give you some corn. So it's like, that's pretty cool. So now, next steps in my life is to make some next mall and learn how to make my own corn tortillas.
You know, Matt, it's admirable. It's admirable. Yeah. You're giving it your all to make sure that you can adapt to your environment.
You know, if you don't have it, you got to make it yourself. So I guess that's what happens when you grow up in Texas and Garland specifically, and then move to Denver. So whatever. Other than that, some other cool research that I've seen lately that I'll show you guys is Jason Hale came out with a blog post the other day on a cool location in the Windows events. And this is pretty cool. So there is a Windows events where you can actually pull out the volume serial numbers. And previously this was heavily relied on for the EMD management to deal with ReadyBoost. But now that ReadyBoost is not always on by default, it's kind of hard to find a good way to link up volume serial numbers. Mm-hmm. Obviously, volume serial numbers are important to us. We find them in the log, the link files, and the jump list. And it's a way that you can relay back to which device a file was accessed on, right? So, but without that ReadyBoost information, it was very difficult to pinpoint, you know, that device information as well, because you didn't always have that volume serial number to link it back to a drive with its serial number and manufacturing information on it. So, I'll show you where it is and how you can view it.
Mitch says, hey guys, everyone's looking and sounding great over here in Denmark. Hey Mitch, hopefully we'll see you in Vegas.
Huh, of course, my VM that I have up, I cannot access it with sharing my screen where I could earlier because, I don't know, man, Google Hangouts is just sometimes really buggy.
If you, I figured this out. If Chrome is running in a user context, it can't share the screen of anything running in an admin context.
But what's weird is I could do it earlier. I tested it, and it showed that I could show my remote or my VM. Anyways, so I guess I'll just have to share the whole desktop.
Dun, dun, dun.
So you might not get that level of viewing.
Here we go.
Anyways, so here in our it's going to be under the Microsoft Windows partition, and we're looking at the diagnostic log. Right now there's zero events. Let me plug in a USB device.
So Matt, is this enabled by default?
So it's a new Windows 10 thing, according to Jason's blog. Which makes sense. So I've done a lot of searching before to find these volume serial numbers because they're kind of important, and to no luck. So I'm glad that he found this and put it in a blog post because this is super useful. So if we go down here, it's cool because it actually gives you a dump of the partition table, the MBR, the VBR, right? So this is the device I just plugged in. We get some serial number information, which is great. So generally our go-to artifact for finding USB information is oftentimes the registry, right? And then we also know that we can mix in the setup API logs with that to kind of find a little bit more information out. And then the Windows events are not often as looked at as much. However, there is quite a bit of USB information that you can find in here, the majority of which is going to be under the plug and play events. And then you'll also have some for, I believe it was the kernel, the driver framework or something.
Yep.
I can't remember the exact event log for it.
Yeah, the plug and play and driver framework, yeah.
So, and I believe there's a couple more in there too. It's been a minute since I looked at it. But so this one is cool because I didn't know about this one until I saw Jason's post on it. Anyways, so if we go down here, we can actually get the full dump of the VBR table, which is great because that's actually what contains the volume serial number. So if we throw that dub into our hex editor, and for NTFS at offset 72 is where our volume serial number is. So, and of course, you can always go and use something like FTK Imager. Mm-hmm. We can verify this. Mm-hmm. It's always good to know how to do some verification, right? So if we go look at our NTFS volume and we go hit up our properties, we can see our volume serial number. So then, you know, we can verify this. D72. So there's our 1CA5 and then our 24DD. Mm-hmm. So there you go. So again, this is really cool because it's getting harder and harder to rely on the ready boost information for this. Yeah. So sure. To know, this is great information. Fantastic.
Well, especially since now not only getting the volume serial number, you're actually getting the first block, so you actually determine the file system is.
Yeah, that's true. So I mean, you could take that even further. I mean, you're getting the MBR, so if you know there was some MBR type stuff on there, you could verify stuff with that. So I mean, there's a lot of places you could take this. Now, if you went to go and try and automate some type of parser, you know, if you're just pulling out the contents of the event log, you're only getting a hex string, right? Mm-hmm. So you're going to have to do some type of interpretation on your parser side to make that, you know, readable if you were wanting to correlate to other things. Mm-hmm. So anyways, I thought that was a great... great blog post by Jason. Yep. And if you haven't checked it out, you can follow him, Jason Hale, at Jason Hale.
And I would guess this is going to be integrated into his USB detector product.
I would assume so. Yeah. And I think I saw some other stuff on there that he had thrown into his tool using Windows Events. Yeah. But yeah, so it's good to remember that Windows Events does have a lot of good USB information. Mm-hmm. And so when you're doing your USB analysis, make sure you're checking your Windows Events. Both the plug and play is great too. Mm-hmm. Anyways, that's what I got for you.
No, that's great, and I'm glad you're able to work, because if not, Lee would feel suggesting that you should use Interpretive Dance. So
right,
I think that worked a lot better. Hi, Nicole.
Hey, Dave.
So for those of you who remember when Nicole used to be in the room more often, she's been a little busy.
Yeah.
And she's getting ready to show some of the products of her work coming up at the DFR Summit.
Well, talk about it, I guess. I don't have anything ready right now to show.
Well, you don't have anything ready right now to show because you're going to talk about the summit. But let's the title of your presentation isn't a secret. It's been on the summit agenda for a while.
Mm-hmm, that's correct.
And so what is the title, Nicole?
So it's Event Trace Logs, Windows Event Trace Logs.
Yes.
Which actually, going back to what Matthew was talking about, he was looking at a diagnostic Windows event. And some of that information I actually seen in ETLs also. So you could determine the size of the partition number, the volume label that it was assigned to. So some of these ETLs contain that information. And there's a specific one, and I can't remember exactly what it is. Event Trace Logs are very similar to Windows event logs.
Correct.
And they're based off of trace logging technologies, which Windows also uses for Windows event logs.
Speak into the microphone. Clausing can't hear you.
Okay. So event trace logs, they have the extension .etl. They're found all over the Windows operating system. Mm-hmm. Not many people know how to parse them, what they are, because they're pretty much in... I would say binary format for the most part, and they rely on an external manifest file to decode.
They do, and for those of you who were Windows administrators for years, you may be familiar with ETLs in other ways.
Mm-hmm.
Like you can do a network diagnostic and store the data in ETL, or you could do a network sniff and store the data in ETL, and you could have all sorts of applications generating ETLs. And the best way that I've described it to other people, and you tell me how I'm getting this wrong, is no, because she's looked farther into this than I have, and so I just try to explain things in ways people can understand. Event logs are what the system generates. ETLs are what applications generate, and the developer gets to choose what's in their ETL and whether or not there is an ETL and the default logging and all the rest. And that means that ETLs are everywhere. And if you remember, long time ago on the lunch, we actually briefly talked about ETLs, and I pulled up on my system and said, hey, look, there's 500 of these suckers. It's on my default system, logging all sorts of information. And at the time, Nicole was looking into this as well. And so what she has found, and what I'm going to kind of prod her about here to talk about before her talk,
yeah,
is
not too much, though.
Not too much. You can't give away everything. You know, they can't leave for barbecue during Nicole's talk. No. is just how damn useful this stuff is, which leads to Nyan's question of how are they useful in real-world problems. You would be surprised at the stuff that is in these ETLs. Now, I'm not going to tell you that this is some forever journal of data that solves all your problems, but there are definitely situations that ETLs handle that nothing else does without having memory. So having said all that, Nicole, there is obviously a native parser by Microsoft to look at ETLs, but let's talk about your use of that and why you decided to move on from it.
Okay, so let me go back a little bit to when you were talking about application diagnostics.
Please.
So yes, it is true, when you can write code that sends diagnostic information or records to a tracelog so you can review it later, the application can also bring it back in if it crashed and see what happened and so on and so forth. But there's also the operating system.
Yes.
The operating system has its own shutdown and a boot log. Yep. Yeah, startup log. So it's the shutdown CKCL, which is a circular kernel context logger, and the shutdown and the boot. Yeah, boot CKCL file. So this stores information related to the boot process.
It does.
And also the shutdown process. Mm-hmm. So in one example, if you want to hear a little sneaky thing that I'll go into more depth in the presentation, is that I've found indicators of compromise in a capture the flag type computer where I have exfiltrated ETLs from. So I could see nice little tidbits of information that I'll share with you in that process.
Now, I want to talk a little bit more about what Nicole did, because I think she just found a fantastic new source of evidence for us to go after. So if you're not familiar, there are multiple services out there now, commercial, free, training, not training, of these security capture the flag hack challenges. And there's all these people out there trying to break in all sorts of different ways. And that's great for them. But what they've unintentionally created is this huge sandbox of all these attacks that people have been created.
Yes, it was beautiful.
And if you break in, you get to take all that forensic data back for testing.
Yeah, so I exfiltrated all of my ETL files and just ran it through a parser, which is what you were asking about last, which was why I went away from that.
Yes.
So Microsoft, you can download Microsoft Message Analyzer, which will parse these files, and you can go through and review them. I believe it only does one at a time. I haven't looked it into it a great deal, but it'll only parse one file at a time. You have to have a lot of background software installed, and you have to set it up a very precise way to have it decode these ETLs properly. And even some ETL files cannot be decoded because Microsoft Message Analyzer can't find the manifest to decode it.
Correct.
So what I've done was I created my own Python script that will take in a whole directory of ETLs, and I've exfiltrated as many, so I've created, you can actually, there are built-in Microsoft tools to create XML files based off of the services that are running that decode ETL files for you. So I have pulled all those XML files together, and my tool will go through each ETL file and go back to the manifest and decode things, because you cannot see the, you cannot interpret the raw structures of these files without the XML files, which is why so many people are like, what in the world are these files on my disk? I don't know what it is. I can see some strings in there, but what really is it?
Right.
So that's...
No, and it's great, especially because there is actually data that is being excluded by the Microsoft parse, too.
Yeah, so there's some, if that's, can you explain what you mean by?
So like the Wi-Fi stuff?
Yeah, so there's some, so what happens is every time these the providers, the XMLs are typically stored in the DLLs, and some are private and some are public. So Microsoft sometimes keeps those those XML manifests private, mm-hmm. which is stored in the PDB, which is the program debug database. And throwing me out of a lot of...
No, do it. People love it.
A lot of acronyms right now. And sometimes those debug databases are private, or yep. it was updated. I'm not sure if it would get lost, but yep. the application updates itself and no longer needs that debug database. So you end up with these ETLs that are no longer, you know, parsable.
Yep.
So yeah, sometimes you cannot, no matter.
Yeah, no matter what you do. And yeah. and this is what it comes down to normally in forensics, right? Is that we have to have non-native tools to parse the data to get all the data. Because if we just trust the developers' tools, we just get what they think is useful. Mm-hmm. And so we have to go back. And Nicole went back through the structure. And there is one other forensics tool right now for parsing ETLs that I'm aware of. Mm-hmm. That's from TZWorks. But unfortunately, yeah. I don't have the enterprise license of TZWorks to test it, so I can't say what it's doing or not doing. I'd love to see it at some point, but we'll see what happens. Nyan says, can you tell us whether a good forensic analyst can become a good malware security analyst? That is a very good question, and we will talk about that later. Joe says, sounds similar to the crazy Ondas format for Apple Unified Logs. Yes and no, Joe. When you see the data, you understand. Hopefully, Joe, you'll be at the summit, and you'll see this. And we can go get drinks.
Come see my talk. Yeah. Absolutely.
Well, and it's not been a short-term obsession.
No. This has been going on since early 2016, want to say. It's been quite a while.
It has.
That I've been just looking into this and going over it, because it's very, very, very convoluted. It has so many different factors that you have to kind of incorporate and take into account, and there's so many different types of trace logging utilities. So,
yes.
you know, there are different versions, different kinds of ETLs. Like mm-hmm. one ETL might be a trace logging technology that was introduced, I think, in either Windows 8 or Windows 10. And Windows 7 has its own trace logging technology that it uses, and, you know, so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the trace logging technologies going forward are always backwards compatible. But if you were to load a Windows 10 ETL on a Windows 7 system, it'll be like, don't like this.
Yep.
And it depends on, obviously, the version that's being used.
So from the testing that we've done and the work we've done with them, they've been incredibly useful. I'm looking forward to seeing people's reactions when Nicole gets to talk about it in full. And then, of course, once it's done, we'll talk about it a lot more as well. I'll have Nicole on to talk more about her work. And then at some point see about releasing a parser in some form.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, at least something that can go through and, you know, do yes. multiple files at once and dump it out into all kinds mm-hmm. of, you know, reports for you to view.
But obviously I'm aware of what she's found. we are in the same office. So I'm very, very excited to see the larger public be able to see this, and then have her draft pending blog post that's been there forever go out.
I know. It has been. giving me research ideas.
Well, there's more. There's more, but other cases have to end first before we can talk about them.
That is true.
All right. So I think that is... Anything else you want to talk about?
No, that's right. It. Just come see the SANS DFR Summit. It's going to be great. So join us down there in Austin. Mm-hmm. We'll have some great food and you'll get some great talks.
There will be barbecue. Yeah. Yes. And forensics. So thanks, everybody, for listening and realizing that, you know, we won't get everything right now, but it will be worth the wait. And I'm hoping you're interested in maybe Googling now if you weren't before when we first talked about it. So let's talk to Max. Max.
Hey.
Max, a lot has changed in your life since you were last on the Forensic Lunch.
Yeah, that's right. 2 years ago, right?
Yeah, it was. So for those who don't remember, 2 years ago, we were, you know, watching the Twitters, as you do, and saw the Lima Charlie release that was out. And, you know, we downloaded it. We tested it. We thought it was amazing. We had Max on. And at the time, Max was in a different country, a different job, and in a different state in the application. And let's just work through this, Matt. Max, where do you want to start?
When you put it that way. I mean, when we talked, I think, you know, we were about halfway through kind of the life cycle of the open source Lima Charlie. Mm-hmm. It was an interesting solution. It had its drawbacks. You know, it wasn't as stable as it, you know, should have been. Mm-hmm. And you know, I was doing this on the side, so at the time I used to work at Google. So since then, really what you know, what we've decided to do, and I say we because we turned this into a company, and mm-hmm. we said Let's take, you know, Lima Charlie, I think, kind of showed that a lot of the endpoint technology, you know, the endpoint EDR kind of capability could really go much further, I think,
yes,
and could be more accessible as well, mm-hmm. right? So what we've decided to do is to start a company. So I left Google. We decided to start a company and to reshape Lima Charlie in a way that would make it very interesting. But you know, beyond that, it's kind of to make it usable for, you know, I'm going to say the masses, but yes. really, you know, enterprise researchers, all kinds of people. So it's kind of brought in some pretty big changes mm-hmm. into Lima Charlie, which, you know, I can chat a little bit about.
Good.
But the idea is that good timing. right, but the idea is that, you know, we wanted to take it from kind of this experimental technology that you develop, you'd put up on your own box, mm-hmm. and make it into a robust, stable service for everybody out there. So the, you know, the highlight notes are that now we have LimaCharlie.io, which is actually we were in private beta for a short while, and now we're just fully open today. And what it is, it's a cloud environment. That is based on a lot of the technology from Lima Charlie. Obviously, it's evolved quite a bit.
Yes.
And we give you a free tier of 2 sensors, and we are flat pricing of 50 cents per sensor per month after. There's no minimum. We really wanted to kind of put it the entry to be able to say, like, you know, vast majority of people can afford it. And even so, when it's not necessarily in, you know, in a large company context, like, researchers could use it and mm-hmm. you know, use it as part of their analysis, mm-hmm. you know, through their workday. So the biggest thing, that the biggest kind of change that's been around Lima Charlie has been that we used to do everything. So Lima Charlie used to, you know, do all the way from the sensors all the way to storing the data and then, like, pivoting it and tables and visualization. And I mean, I think we got some really nice things through mm-hmm. that, mm-hmm. but there's also some pretty, you know, big difficulties in doing that. So doing retention of data yep. Kind of in a way that works for everybody is nearly impossible. Mm-hmm. The pivoting, you know, the uptime, all these things were very difficult. So what we've decided to do is we said, let's focus on providing the capability that nobody else provides. Mm-hmm. So is there other people that provide the capability to store large amounts of data and do some visualization over it?
Maybe a couple. Yeah. Maybe a couple.
a couple. And they do an amazing job, you know? So we said, okay, well, the retention aspect then is not really where we can provide most benefit. Mm-hmm. Where we can provide benefit is in giving the endpoint capability to people and doing it in as much of a drop-in capability as we could. Mm-hmm. So that means, you know, you don't have to install, you know, a farm of servers and, you know, talk to, you know, various salespeople to go through a contract process to set up these things and then, you know, all of the complexity that goes around endpoint. And then you're stuck with, you know, their solution of storage. So we said, okay, if we want to be a drop-in capability, mm-hmm. we need to be kind of a middleware. And what that means is people install sensors in their company on, you know, their dev box, on their analysis sandboxes, whatever they want. We're still cross-platform, so Linux, OS X, Windows. It's still in real time, and so we still have the ability to kind of receive events, do something, you know, detect something and do something about it. And then when we get to the question of, you know, what do we do with the data from those endpoints? Well, we're going to ask the customer. So most customers out there, you know, have an ELK stack or mm-hmm. a large Splunk deployment. Mm-hmm. So for us to just replicate this and do it in a pretty bad way is not beneficial to anyone. So what we do is, in LimaCharlie.io, through the web interface, you just say, you know, I want my data sent over syslog, you know, TLS syslog at, you know, this address, this port, and the data starts flowing there. Mm-hmm. the format is, you know, JSON. It's a format that we've enhanced compared to what we used to have, just to make it that much friendlier for people to kind of browse through. If you don't have your own Splunk instance or ELK stack, you know, quite honestly, what I do, what we do is we go and we use the Splunk free tier, mm-hmm. Because right out of the box, it's very easy to ingest the data, the JSON, it understands JSON. You can do your queries through your own data, see the data come in live. So that's kind of what's the biggest change that really happened. Mm-hmm. Is we said, okay, we're not going to do the retention, we're going to just provide it to the customer the way they want. There's a lot of very nice operational things that we've introduced as well, right? So I say, you know, we send the data, but in reality, we're able to send different subsets of the data to different places, mm-hmm. Through different means. So we support S3 buckets. So some customers that we have say, I want all of the detections that are generated pretty much early to the IO, and I'll kind of get into that a bit. Mm-hmm. And I want to send those over syslog to, you know, my SIM, whatever mm-hmm. it is. But then all the bulk events, it's potentially a lot of data. So I'm just going to send it to an S3 bucket, mm-hmm. and I have a data retention period set up on there, and then I don't have to worry about it. Mm-hmm. And if stuff happens, I see a detection, I can just pull from it, and mm-hmm. I just get my JSON right away. Mm-hmm. So you're able to do this. You know, there's tagging of sensors. You're able to specify by specific tags and all these kind of really nice operational things. At the end of the day, one of the usage kind of scenarios that we had in mind was we wanted for somebody, you know, anywhere in the world that says, you know, I have some really great ideas of, you know, how to run a SOC or how to be an MSS. And I want to open a business that does this. We wanted it to be kind of a pop-up stuff. Mm-hmm. And so that's really what you get, because there's no minimum. You go in 2 minutes, you have your own organization that's mm-hmm. multi-tenant, you create multiple organizations. Mm-hmm. You can enroll the sensors, do various installation keys, the REST API. So everything that we do, because we don't do retention, you have to be able to interact with us in a very simple way.
Right.
And so we have a very complete REST API that allows you, you know, to manage sensors and manage your deployment, but also go in and task specific sensor. So when you kind of take all of these things together and you put them in one environment, you just end up with this amazingly flexible way of having an endpoint capability. You know, we have many, many different MSS that, you know, have come into us and said, you know, we can't really, you know, deal with other EDR products.
Right.
They're too expensive. We can't pass on the cost to our customers.
Mm-hmm.
So they've been able to just get up and running, and the cost is very minimal, and you're not stuck in somebody else's environment, so they can, right. you know, run their own data retention, everything like that. You know, some of the other kind of highlight capabilities that are really cool are that we still do what we call the detection and response. So it's now a very simple way in a tiny, you know, YAML format.
Mm-hmm.
It's a way for you to encode a detection rule and to couple it with a response rule. And you upload it to the server. So in some ways, it's kind of like the whole serverless thing, you know, with AWS Lambda,
mm-hmm.
where you don't have to maintain the server. You just send it. And in real time, we start applying that. So, you know, you could start saying, you know, for things that are as simple as, you know, if a sensor comes in and that sensor is tagged with VIP, and you know, I see that it's an executable that's in the recycler bin.
Mm-hmm.
Then that's a detection
yep.
rule, and then you give it a tiny YAML response, and you can say isolate the host. So mm-hmm. send the tasking to just isolate that host. So you can start really creating some pretty complex automation flows, right, around all of that. And the tasking is still kind of the same, more robust tasking that was available in Lima Charlie. So you could start and say, you know what, I want to, you know, do a memory dump of that process, or I want to run this specific Yara signature on that one process in memory because we have built-in Yara. So you're not, you know.
What I love about this conversation, Max, is that you assume everyone knows everything your product does. Now, I obviously, obviously, I am familiar and I'm loving this conversation, but I think a lot of people right now are going, holy crap, really? Really? Oh, it does that? It can isolate hosts on the network and does in-memory dumps and Yara process. We should probably step back a second and actually explain what it is that you could do because it's really cool.
Yeah, absolutely. And thank you. Thank you for saying that because it's, you know, I, as you can probably tell, I'm pretty enthusiastic about this.
Yes.
I feel we finally built the system that I really would have liked, you know, a few years ago.
Exactly. Mitch has a question. He wants to know if there's anything that is there specifically for ICS, industrial control systems.
That is a good question. Not specifically at the moment. It's cross-platform. So, you know, whatever the platform is very likely going to be fine. A lot of stuff, I think, also runs in the ICS world, although I'm not as familiar, I'm going to be honest, on kind of older Windows. Mm-hmm. So we support all the way to XP.
There you go.
Yeah, there's certain things that that kind of it degrades nicely, but it does degrade, you know, about getting various types of data on Windows XP 32-bit. But it works, and you know what? You get the same data through the same channel in the same format, same thing. And the I would say that one thing I have not mentioned, and I won't go too deep into it, but because those detection and response rules are very modular, we're also beginning to introduce the ability for people to share those rules. And to kind of review those things and to make it very easy for somebody else to just say, I want to subscribe to this and apply it in this slightly different way on my organization.
Very nice.
So if you have some ideas, you know, we've seeded that, you know, that list of, but, you know, I that'd be pretty awesome to see some ICS stuff in there. I'm sure there'd be interested people.
All right. So let's start with the website.
Yeah. How about I can actually put it up.
Let's do that. Let's do that. That's a great idea.
All right. Let's see. So, there we go.
All right. I'm going to draw a new window to show his screen.
I can also kind of, you know, make it bigger or smaller or whatever.
No, this should be fine. This should be fine. Let me go ahead and get it right there. All right, good to go.
All right, good stuff. So this is kind of the dashboard that you see. These are all of what we refer to the add-ons that I just mentioned around various rules that I've subscribed to in this particular organization. So I will go in, you know, my own organization. We go in, we can see the list of sensors that we have online. Most of this is kind of management type stuff. So the way that you enroll the sensor is, you know, you download the installer for the sensor and it's publicly available. And when you install it, you give it an installation key. Mm-hmm. That key, you can create as many as you want. And what you do is you say, you know, you give it a description, but more importantly, you can also give it various tags that you want the sensors enrolling this to have. Mm-hmm. So you can see in this case, pretty simple, but I have VIP laptop and VIP server. So if I have a larger organization, I can say, you know, my sales department uses this key and they automatically get tagged. Mm-hmm. And I can use those tags with everything else. The other big chunk I mentioned is the output.
Yep.
So now here I have a bunch of different outputs configured. You know, a lot
integration.
Of it is just a,
what?
Yeah. So we used to have a Slack integration that was quite amazing. And what we've done is we've gone back to it and we're kind of rebuilding it from the ground up so that it's solid. Mm-hmm. But at the moment, the Slack integration will allow you to say, you know, I want all of, well, actually, this is exactly what I have here. So I want all of the auditing events from, you know, my Lima Charlie deployment to go mm-hmm. to a specific Slack channel. Mm-hmm. And I want all the detections to go there too.
Nice.
So whenever anything happens, I, you know, I see a pop-up of, you know, the detection hitting, and then I will see, you know, if I'm sending automated commands, tasking, I'll see those go out, and I can kind of keep an eye out in a real-time fashion what's going on. And then you have the detections and the events, and you can do some further filtering into it, but, you know, that gets a bit into the weeds. We have the detection rules. Mm-hmm. So those are the ones that I mentioned. So you can kind of see basic things. So here, you know, the very first one, it's the Windows Recon. So I'm taking this as a resource, a Lima Charlie resource. So it's a subscription that I've, you know, subscribed. Everything's free. Mm-hmm. And then I'm saying, well, if I, you know, if I detect it, then as a response, I don't know, it may not be super visible, but the response side there says, report win recon. Mm-hmm. So that will generate the detection. Mm-hmm. And then, task history dump, which will tell my sensor, hey, give me everything that you've recorded, you know, over the last X amount of time, mm-hmm. Because that might be something to mention for people that are not, you know, as familiar with Lima Charlie, but Lima Charlie produces tons of events. You know, we go all the way to every file write, file creation, mm-hmm. but we can't send it all to the cloud. Right. So we send a specific subset. That being said, you're able to, in real time, query the sensor and tell it, hey, I know you keep a cache of everything that's happened for the last like 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. Just dump me everything. Or you can say, you know, for the next 5 minutes, I want you to give me all TCP connections mm-hmm. and UDP connections, like mm-hmm. all of the details, things like that. Hmm.
So Trey has a question. He says, Slack could be used for an ongoing historic log of events, and admins could add comments to potential problems and how it's solved and investigated.
That is absolutely correct. And the next, you know, logical step for that, it kind of goes back to what the Slack integration used to be in the open source version, where it allowed you to, in fact, interact with the sensor as well. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So the idea is you'd be able to, you know, tell the LC bot, you know, send a history dump to this sensor, kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And you know, this is one integration. One thing that comes out of kind of a lot of the features that we have, like the output, right? You can configure an output through the REST interface. And if I show very briefly the REST interface, you know, it looks like this. Because you can do that, everything is based on REST. There's a syslog output. It means that we also have a Python API that helps you to interact with the REST.
You keep saying all the right things, Max.
Pardon?
You keep saying all the right things.
It's almost as if I built something that I really, really wanted.
I know.
So you can use that Python API to just say, you know, there's a wrapper for what we call the fire hose, where you say, you know what, I want to open a fire hose to limacharlie.io. And what that is, you know, here's my API key. It takes care of all the authentication for you, but then it will create a temporary output, syslog, for example, to a specific tag. So you can say all my VIP sensors. And then immediately what starts happening is you start getting a flow of the data from those sensors to, you know, effectively your Python script that opened a syslog, you know, TCP endpoint and starts receiving the data. So you can start having, you know, real-time dedicated specific kind of flows for your data. Or you can have an interactive console with your sensors by having a fire hose, and then in the Python API, we have a command line interface to send tasks to sensors. So, you know, we put a lot of emphasis on that integration. Mm-hmm. So the detections, there's, you know, many different types. All the way from kind of very simple stateless that we call, you know, look at an event and see, say if it's bad or not, to some stateful stuff like the Win Recon actually is one of those, mm-hmm. where we say, for example, you know, if I see ipconfig execute more than 3 times in 5 seconds, mm-hmm. It might be some kind of automated recon. Mm-hmm. And so we can generate detections off of that. We have different feeds as well. So the corn blocker is an example. So we mirror internally those feeds from, you know, free feeds from organizations out there. Mm-hmm. and we allow you to subscribe to it and automatically diff all of your DNS requests that come back to Lima Charlie with those lists, and you'll get a detection.
Now, I like the one called Shadow Volume Tampering.
Yeah. let's see. So, you know, one of the things that we do is we want to really encourage people to kind of play with those rules. So most of the rules that you see here, we've actually put open publicly so you can see exactly what they are, how they're structured, and writing a guide to help you do that. Mm-hmm. In the case of the shadow volume tampering, let me see if I forget if it's in the actual doc, or I think that's right, we put it in a different repo. I'm just gonna open that for a second. It is in rules. What a great name. There you go. So if we look at the shadow volume tampering, we have in YAML and JSON format. It's fairly simple, as you can see. Mm-hmm. And so what it's, you know, what the rule looks like is, well, we're going to end all of these clauses if it's a new process event and it's from a Windows box. Then we're going to OR these things, and we are saying if the file path ends with zssadmin.exe, so it fits that particular executable, and the command line matches this, then we're going to generate that detection.
Seems wise.
WMIC, shadow copy. I'm sorry, what did you say?
It seems like a good idea, yeah.
Yeah. It's basic. It's certainly not rocket science.
No, but it's a nice, easy, codified way. It's easy to write. It's easy to see and explain. And then you can create detections and responses. It's amazing.
That's right. The example that I've been using since last year, I guess, pretty often, to me is really close to my heart. It's I was at a conference in Montreal, I think the day after WannaCry came in. And, you know, you could read on Twitter about WannaCry, what does it look like? It was really easy to spot if you looked for it. I mean, it was a single static executable name. Like, this is not rocket science.
Right.
But for some people, they were still, having a lot of trouble with it because whatever vendor they had just didn't have anything for it. And, they'd say, we'll have something tomorrow.
Yeah.
And that's cool, but tomorrow might be too late. So on the spot, I kind of turned around and said, okay, what can a sysadmin on a system like this do the morning that he sees on Twitter that WannaCry is exploding? Mm-hmm. And I think it's actually in the doc where we have, we describe it a little bit here, where we say, well, if a new process has a file path and it's this executable name, then this is WannaCry.
Yep.
And what we want to do is, report WannaCry, dump the history so we get a good idea of what happened. Mm-hmm. And then in this case, we said deny tree, which was, kill it, kill whatever WannaCry is. We could have added isolate the host if we really wanted to make sure. Mm-hmm. And this takes, 2 minutes to write.
Yeah.
It's not going to prevent it the same way that an AI-driven ML thing works.
But it's something you can do yourself and easily share.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's right. So Exactly. So it's a lot of really interesting stuff. And if we kind of go, keep going quickly, we have different kinds of logs. Mm-hmm. You can see the last errors, audit logs, all that kind of stuff. Obviously, a sensor download. Mm-hmm. We have a simple link you can reuse everywhere because it's always the same sensor with a wget. The API keys. So you can create as many API keys as you want. And so you're able to kind of, delete a key if it got leaked out somehow, somewhere, use them, the identity of those keys gets propagated with all of the actions within the audit log, all that good stuff, and then the add-on. So this is here the beginning of the list of all the add-ons that I have, enabled on my company, giving me a little bit of high-level information. So there's various APIs you can enable, in this case, enable both. We have two lookup types of add-ons. So those are very, you know, basic feeds that you can get out there. So CoinBlocker, malware domain. And finally, the detections. And so you can put some information around the detection, subscribe. And I, you know, one thing that I really like with those detection add-ons is you don't have to use it in exactly the same way that the person who created that detection wanted. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is we all have different environments, right? How often have you, pushed some kind of rule to an environment and said, you know, this should never happen. Like the classic, again, you know, there's an EXE in the recycler bin.
Yeah.
This okay. should not happen.
Correct.
And then you realize that the finance department bought some software from somebody in Ukraine, and that person thought it was a great idea to manage their update mechanism through Recycler. And you know, that can really screw you over. So the way we structured the add-ons is we give you access to that resource. We give you access to that component of the detection. But if you want to couple it with, you know, some limiting things for your organization, you can say, you know, in your rule, if, you know, it's not tagged as sales, then, you know, apply this, mm-hmm. Or vice versa. So you can make it customized and more relevant to your own environment.
Very, very cool. And 50 cents a host.
Yes, that's right. So that's the, you know, it used to be an open source project. A lot of people had a lot of interest in it. A lot of people were happy to see it, you know, become more formalized. I had a pretty strong, thing that I wanted, which was I wanted to bring this to you know, the masses.
Yeah.
I did not want this to be a $50 thing that,
exactly.
you know, exactly. So some, you know, some person in university who's studying, you know, who's doing their OS course and decides that they, you know, they're really interested to see what happens on their computer. So it, and there's a free tier. If you want to run a course, if you want to run, you know, your sandboxing mm-hmm. stuff off of that, like it's, you know, it's very accessible.
Mm-hmm. For sure. And
yeah.
We sell commercial software, and we also have open source stuff. I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with mixing it. I mean, if anyone is in the position where they don't have to make money, or someone else is giving them money and allowing them to make open source works, that's great. But I mean, your company needs profit to exist, and I understand that. I think other people do as well. You know, for those of us who have especially like products and open source projects that become supported and continued development.
that's absolutely true. And you know, I think it's a good trade-off at the end of the day to mm-hmm. have something that's beyond the prototype stage that you can use, you know. Just thought I'd show a bit what, you know, the events look like in Splunk. Mm-hmm. Pretty detailed stuff, the yes. routing, so you get all of the tags of your specific sensor mm-hmm. as they come in, IPs relating to them, the architecture, you know, the OS, all that good stuff.
very nice. No, it's great. And I mean if people haven't looked at this in 2 years since the last time you're on, a lot has changed. And even 2 years ago, it was impressive of what it could do. I mean, for those who for those who remember the last broadcast, he was on when the Carbon Black representative was on, you know, talking about some of his research around volume shadow copies and ransomware and the like. He was like, wow, this is very similar to other tools out there that are being commercially sold. So, I mean, you've gone even further from there. And I think one of the things that you mentioned that I would love for you to talk about more, because I think this is something I haven't heard a lot about, you're doing Yara not just on disk, but in memory?
Yes, that's right. Thank you for pointing that out. I think there's a lot of features that you know, we kind of forget about in all of it. Yeah, that's right. So Yara is compiled into the sensor, mm-hmm. And you're able to kind of operate it in two main ways. So the first one is you can upload a single, you know, Yara signature, or mm-hmm. you know, if you kind of glob it all together, a Yara set of rules, And you can tell the sensor continually scan for this. As most people that have used Yara know, it's very, very, very easy to spike a box, the CPU peg it. So what we do is we add some throttling to this to be able to say, you know, you might have a large rule set, and it, sometimes you want that rule set to be constantly scanned in your computer. You don't necessarily care that it's done in 1 hour versus, you know, 1 day or one week, but it's just continuous. So that's kind of that mode. It will scan, it will look at all the processes that are running, all the modules that they're running. It will go and scan the files on this, and then it will go and scan the memory for this process. So it can take a while to, obviously. And then the second mode is one where you can actually directly task your sensor to say, you know, I want to use this signature one time to scan this process or, you know, this process pattern or things like that. And in which case, in that case, it'll go and it'll just do it very quickly because it's, you know, one process. It's kind of the assumption is kind of, you know, more what you're getting into. And because this is a tasking, it's integrated in the DNR rule, which means you can start building really interesting flows. If I saw this analysis, you know, this suspicious process, I'm going to trigger a scan of that process with that rule set that looks for, you know, some specific Bitcoin miners and memory, whatever it is.
And then you could dump or isolate or anything else you want to do.
That's right. That's right. So the dump is you can specify any specific chunk of memory that you want to dump. So it could be, you know, 4 bytes if you want. And the isolation is a network isolation. So you know, the sensor maintains connectivity, so you can still do your thing, but it stops the host from connecting all over the place. And you know, there's a lot of other features that we kind of want to over time roll in. We've had a lot of requests of, you know, you were talking earlier about Windows event log. So we want to have the ability to exfil some of those. Obviously, anybody who's looked at, you know, Windows event logs, you got to be careful how much you send back. So we're kind of taking cautious steps and figuring out how to do that. But yeah, a lot of other features like that.
That's awesome. And is there somewhere where all of these features are actually written down?
Yes.
If someone wanted to know more, find out more, show their friends, where would they go?
Yeah. So the best way right now to get kind of the doc. So our full doc is available. It's a repo. It's also page doc.limacharlie.io. And there you will get a lot of the information you're interested in. So this is the capability for detection and response. And we have the sensor command here. We have information about, you know, what those commands do, as well as the usage for all of those. So in this case, if you look Yara scan, you can see it's you know, it doesn't really get any much simpler in the net. Yeah, you know, specify all that stuff.
Nice.
There's also, I think you'll also see some references to features that I haven't mentioned, like the doc cache. So where, you know, you can cache a PDF whenever it gets created. So if you determine after the fact that it was, you know, some kind of exploit, you can go and retrieve it from the cache, things like that. So it's all in the doc. And then if you want the let's say marketing level page is limacharlie.io. And if you just want to create an account and go at it and have a look, it's app.limacharlie.io.
Very nice. Now, I mean, I think it's great. I loved watching the evolution of your solution, how you've added on to it, how you've continued to work with it. I mean, let's face it. There's lots of people out there with different ideas and lots of solutions that people are doing. I've always really liked your approach to this, and I've been a fan of how you've done it. So I like it.
Awesome. Thank you.
I like it a lot, and I'm gonna start playing with it more. I've actually had some of my machines on Lima Charlie in the previous instances, and I've played with it since. And I'm looking forward to being able to actually, you know, pay my 50 cents a host to give back a little bit. So I appreciate that. I mean,
awesome.
I've had other people say things like, "Oh, you can have a Patreon, and you can have a Twitch channel," and I'll be honest, you'd be surprised that, you know, people just don't respond. So having an ability to just set a level playing field, especially, you know, at a very reasonable entry point, is the easiest way to give back and show your support. And if you just want to play with it, a two host for free is pretty great. So, Max, that's awesome.
Awesome. Excellent. Happy to do good.
Good.
I love your passion, Max.
So, the hour is up. Neon, you have asked a lot of very interesting questions that I think we're basically just going to have to, like, get on people to respond to all of the different questions you've asked. I really appreciate the questions, though. Maybe we'll get Lenny Zeltzer back on about transitioning into being a malware analyst, and get some other people on about doing network forensics and talking about decrypting TLS and all the other stuff you've been asking about, and where to find a Yara memory paper tutorial. I think if you go to yara.org, that's a good starting point for Yara. And then if you look at the volatility Yara resources, they have a good thing writing up for that as well. But yeah, thanks to all of you who are tuned in live. It's the most fun way to watch the show. You get to ask questions, you get to interject, you know, things that you're interested in or things you want to see covered in future shows. We always appreciate it. If you have a solution that you think is interesting, you're like, well, why is Max on and I'm not? That's because you didn't message me like Max did and said, hey, I have this really cool thing that we should talk about. Now, there is one person out there who has, in fact, done that, and I need to get back to them because I need to see what they're doing. But we're always open to guests. There is no charge to come on the show, in case people were wondering. I've had one marketing person reach out to me. He goes, how much does it cost to get on the Forensic Lunch? And I'm like, nothing. But it's live. People can ask you real questions, so you better have real answers. And they're like, well, we're not coming on. So if you have something you are proud of and ready to show people and really talk about, like, you know, the Black Light guys have done, I've had the people from what is now OpenText on before, you know, come on, you reach out, you know, and be passionate and happy to show the work that you've done and be proud of what you've done. And you should be, because there's a lot of work behind all the tools that we use. And it's, you know, everything has a good, bad, or a flaw, but, you know, everything has a use. So thanks for tuning in. Our next broadcast has been scheduled for May the 18th, so make sure to tune in then. Going to have some more interesting guests on. And until then, for all of us, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.